Okay, so in this session, we will primarily talk about the credit risk. What is the credit risk? How how banks? What are the banks? What are the banking functionalities? What are the different products banks provide? Okay, so in the beginning, I will start with what is banking. That would be very basic stuff. I know for a lot of people, and a lot of people would have covered it as well. But it's a good thing to start, and mostly it would be a refresher for everyone, but let's get started. Okay, so starting from the very very basic, that banking is an industry that handles cash, credit, and other financial transactions. Let me go to the slide. Guys, can you see my screen clearly? I hope nothing is getting cut from the right side. Okay, great. Okay, so as you all know, what is a bank? So banking is an industry in itself, and when you say a bank, the first thing that comes into your mind is money, and that money can be in the form of cash or in the form of credit, which the banks give, or any other financial transactions involving money. Why are banks important for people? Because they provide a safe area where a person or an individual or a customer can park their money, and also they can earn interest on that money. So rather than keeping a lot of money at your home, you can keep it in a bank. It would be a safe place for it, and you will also earn interest on it. And also, demonetization will affect you very less. Okay, so what do banks do? So banks actually channelize this money in the economy and lend further in terms of loans. And loans can be of different types, like credit card, mortgages, auto loans, which we will talk about in the later slides. And how and while they provide loans, they are charging interest from the customers. And while people are making deposits in the bank, they are giving interest to the customers. So the difference between these two interest rates, first, which they are giving to their depositors, and second, which they are charging from their debtors, that is called net interest margin. We will cover that further. And this is the main earning of the bank. Now, if you talk about banks, so when you talk about credit risk, and mostly we will focus here on retail banking. So retail bank is a bank which provides money to the individuals and families. So individuals like you and me, small families, they are often opening joint accounts or taking loans in the name of two or three people. That kind of services are provided by a retail bank. When you talk about commercial bank, so if you are trying to run a business, you want a loan, or you want to make huge deposits of money, you will use the feature of commercial bank. So these commercial banks are separate. So when I say they are separate, doesn't mean that a bank particularly will only serve to retail customers. A bank has different divisions. One division will cater to retail customers. One division will cater to commercial customers. And the third one is investment bank. This is mostly share market related, and for big companies for funding through their public offering the bonds of the company. And they also provide services like if a big company is acquiring a smaller company, so they will also facilitate this and provide services. FIIs or any NRIs which are trying to invest in India or in any other country. So investment bank here comes into picture. So guys, why are banks important in an economy? If the banks wouldn't have been there, would we have survived? And if we would have survived, hi, can you hear me, guys? Hello? Great. Yes. So banks help us survive in a much better fashion in case the banking system was not there. And how do they do that? They primarily work, as I told you in the previous slide, the main principle on which banks work is called financial intermediation. What banks do, they take funds from the savers in terms of deposits, on which they give these depositors interest. And using the same money, they lend it to the people who are actually in need, and right now they do not have the cash flow, which are called borrowers. And the banks charge interest on that. And the difference is called net interest margin. How this complete system helps to make the overall economy more efficient. So, for example, right now, say Asif is having 1 crore of amount with him, but he doesn't know how to use it. So he will put it in a bank, right? And for example, right now I want to buy a car and I don't have enough cash flow with me. So I will go to the bank and I will ask the money that, hey, I need this and this amount of money. So bank will charge me a Y amount of interest rate, and it will give Asif X percent of interest rate. And this Y minus X would be the net interest margin that bank would be earning. So in a way, my needs are satisfied, and the person who's having the extra flow of cash, they also get a safe haven for their cash, and they also earn some interest on that. Okay. So this complete function is depicted in the chart below. So if you see, these savers or the individuals, they deposit their money in the banks, and these banks further give loans to the borrowers. And in an opposite way, the borrowers have to repay these loans back to the bank, and they have to do the interest payments. Guys, this repayment of loans is very important, as this is a major part of credit risk. So if someone is not able to repay the loans or do the partial repayment, that is the credit risk which a bank faces. Okay. And quickly, the amount which is deposited by the depositors in the bank are actually the liabilities, because they have to be paid back to the customer. And the loans which banks give out, they are assets for the bank because they earn on it, and ultimately they have to get them back from the borrowers. Okay. So guys, any question till now? Great. Thanks, Vishal. Thanks, Vinay, for the reply. Okay. Now we will talk about the risks which are faced by the bank. So any business, any activity you do, there has a risk involved with it. And when you talk about the banks, where huge amounts of money is moved from here to there on a regular basis, the risk increases to multi-fold times. So in course of activities, banks may face multiple risks, and the sources of those risks can be many. For example, if there is some expected or unexpected events in the economy or financial markets. Okay. The money which is lent to a customer or the borrowers does not pay it, or they partially repay it. operational mistakes like error from staff in underwriting, and they're not following the bank lending guidelines while giving loans to the customers, may lead to defaults or bad loans, which further results into the risk. And some external factors, like if a person wants to do fraud with the bank or want to hack the website or any account. So I'll give you a very interesting example. So I will not name the bank, but it was actually in terms of, you know, the credit card outstandings or the balances, it is right now on the second rank in US. Around 2 years back, what happened was, suddenly their credit applications increased a lot. Okay. And using the models, they also cleared all the criteria in terms of FICO, in terms of income, in terms of everything. Okay. So suddenly their application rates and approval rates increased manifold. They were able to notice it after 3 months. And when they realized it, there was some hacker which had created multiple accounts, and through online banking, they have applied to loans and they also got approval and disbursal of money. And that loss resulted in few million dollars. So such kind of risks are also faced by the banks. Now, as a banking analytics professional, it is your job to identify and minimize all these risks so that the banking system remains stable, the shareholders do not lose their money, and depositors and investors keep their faith in the banking system, and the economy doesn't crash down. Now, if you talk specifically, there are 8 types of risks that are faced by every bank. The majorly the risks are credit risk, market risk, and operational risk. Apart from that, there are some important risks as well, like liquidity, strategic risk, and reputational risk. And there are some extremely unrelated risks which are called systemic risk or moral hazard. We'll cover them one by one in our next slide. So first one, and the most important one, and the biggest one, is the credit risk. Credit risk is simply nothing but you're giving money or loan to the customers. They are either not repaying it or they are partially repaying it. In both ways, bank suffers losses. So imagine you gave 1 lakh rupee to your friend and they do not give it back, or they gave it only 50,000 of it. So that amount which is gone is your loss. Second is market risk. So as a bank, as a financial institution, bank does not make only loans. They also hold a significant portion of securities. So some of the securities are, for example, they invest the excess money in short-term investment plans or securities, and sometimes they also gave loans against the collaterals. Okay, we will cover more about the securities as collateral against loans in our further slides. Another part is operational risk. So what is operations? So bank has to operate every day. Okay, any problem in their operations, and that can happen because of, for example, of any problem in system, any problem in information technology, or any internal process which breaks down. So that might result in an operational risk. For example, a bank in a day receives multiple applications for loans, and there is a set process to check whether to give a loan to the person or not. Say for example, because of any technology failure, they are not able to process those applications. That is an operational risk. okay, and some of the officials did not follow some procedures or did not follow the internal processes, that is again an operational risk. Now these, as covered in the previous slide, these are the three major risks which a bank faces, and the biggest one is the credit risk, which also resulted in 2008 financial crisis. We will cover that in a further slides. Okay, now let's go to some lesser significant risk. So first is the liquidity risk. So see, a bank receives deposits from multiple people. So for example, if you take any example of Indian bank, say HDFC Bank or ICICI Bank. So there are n number of people maybe running in lakhs and crores which are depositing their money in terms of their savings account or term deposits. Okay. So bank run is a situation. It's actually a hypothetical situation, but it has happened few times in the past that when all depositors, they come to the bank and they say, we want to take our money back. And in that situation, if a bank doesn't have enough flow of money with them, that is a situation of bank. That has happened in early 19th century or very on the late 19th century. But right now we have central bank, like we have RBI in India, you have Federal Bank in US, who are there to help and handle such situations. So in terms of in times of these situations, central bank provide them excess cash or liquidity so that they can handle such situations for a few days, and then they obviously repay back to central banks. Another risk is strategic risk, because of which most of CEOs lose their jobs. So this is the risk faced by the bank when they choose any wrong strategy or they are following some inappropriate business objectives, and they hence end up suffering losses. I will give you an example. If you talk about the Barclays Bank, so Barclays Bank started its operations in India. Okay, right now they are not having any operations, they may have closed it. So when they came to India, what they started doing was they started distributing credit cards to a lot of people who helped them set up banking system in India. So for example, if a businessman or a politician helped them, you know, they gave them credit card more easily on softer terms. They gave cards to students, to low FICO people. Basically, they did not follow their internal processes properly, or they were not strict in providing those loans. And because of that, Barclays Bank India suffered a lot of losses. Also, in terms of the strategies, in a country like India, which is a developing country, and people have a lot of, you know, they handle a lot of cash transactions, they have daily demands. In terms of their branches, they were not as appropriate as compared to Indian system. So this was feedback which was received to them from a lot of people. So different people have different opinions, but some people also cite this reason as their operation failure. So this kind of a risk is a strategic risk. Another example could be you're trying to launch a new product in the market, okay, but you don't design it properly, or you direct it to a not so efficient population, which will give you the optimum results. So those kind of risks are strategic risks. Here, models may not do anything. So models help you to build strategy for CEOs and for senior management. Any wrong strategy will lead to losses, and that is the risk which a bank faces. Now the last two and not so related risk are systemic risk and moral hazard. Systemic risk is simply because in a banking system, the banks are interrelated to each other. And if one bank fails, it has a ripple effect on other banks as well. Sometimes that dynamo keeps on moving and results in a failure of entire financial services industry, which has happened in 2008 recession as well. Now, the last one is moral hazard. Moral hazard is basically any bank which is running in a country has a moral responsibility towards its citizens, which are having confidence in it. They're depositing their hard-earned money in the bank. So if the bank is not able to, repay back to the customers or their depositors, and they do not take their decisions properly, so they will lose their confidence in the population. Here again, the central banks play a very key role because they lay down a lot of rules and regulations for the banks under which these banks have to mandatorily function. So they cannot, go away with these rules. And every year there are a lot of regulatory submissions which are required for the bank to be done to the central bank, so that after the approval from central bank of their strategies, of their models, then only the banks can function. So central banks like Reserve Bank or Federal Bank play a very key role here. Okay, guys. Any quick question on these stuff?